It has been an unusual season for football right across the globe, but nowhere is that more emphatically the case than in Turkey, where the traditional big three all had seasons to forget. Between them, Beşiktaş, Fenerbahçe and Galatasaray have won a combined total of 55 out of a possible 62 Super League titles. Prior to this season, only two other clubs outside of the big three had ever got their hands on a Super League title. Beşiktaş, Fenerbahçe and Galatasaray are all based in Turkey's largest city of Istanbul, which is one of the most football-crazed cities on earth. As well as enormous success, the big three also enjoy enormous support. Their three stadiums have a combined total capacity in excess of 140,000, and the rivalry between the three clubs runs deep. Once known as Byzantium and Constantinople, the city of Istanbul is often referred to as the gateway between the East and the West, as a transcontinental city which bridges Europe and Asia. Istanbul is a vibrant city which is rich in history and culture, but few things unite the citizens of Istanbul more than a love of football, and often a mutual hatred between the three biggest clubs. Sometimes there is only one thing that can bring rival factions together though, and that is a common enemy. The enemy of my enemy is my friend, or so says the ancient proverb, and in the form of Istanbul Beşiktaş, Istanbul's big three have an enemy of epic proportions. Seen as an unwelcome addition to Istanbul's footballing scene by most, Beşiktaş applied the finishing touches to their rise this season by winning a maiden Super League title. It is only the second time in over 35 years that none of the big three have claimed the Turkish title, but Beşiktaş are not hated simply for daring to challenge the supremacy of the big three. Distrust and dislike of the club comes for a myriad of different reasons, not least their close ties to Turkey's president, Recep Tayyip Erdogan. It is at this point that I must make my usual disclaimer that this video has to dip into the murky waters of politics, albeit only briefly, and point out that if you are someone who balks at the mere idea of mixing sport and politics, then this is not the video for you. For those of you who are still tuned in, you will soon realise why it is impossible to discuss the rise of Istanbul Beşiktaş without talking about President Erdogan and the many machinations of Turkish politics. The journey for Istanbul Beşiktaş began in 1990 with the founding of an amateur football club named Istanbul Büyükşehir Belediyespor. The team was created by the merger of three part-time Istanbul clubs, as the brainchild of doctor and politician Nurettin Sözen, who served as the mayor of Istanbul from 1989 to 1994. Quite why Sözen felt Istanbul needed yet another club, given Istanbulspor were also starting to become a force during the 1990s, seems to me to be a little unclear. But Istanbul's latest arrivals took the place of ISK Edirne, another Istanbul club, who had been owned by the city's water board in Turkey's fourth tier. The club was an immediate success, winning two promotions in their first three seasons, propelling them from the lowly amateur leagues to a second tier side by 1993, when they first entered the TFF First League. Their progress hit an early rock in 1995, when the club suffered their first relegation, but two seasons later, they were back in the First League. It was an impressive early rise, but by 2006, the club had spent nine consecutive seasons in the TFF First League, and they hadn't come close to promotion to the Super League in over half a decade. In need of some fresh impetus, the club appointed Istanbul native Abdullah Avcı, who had just spent 12 months coaching Turkey's under-17 national team. In his first season in charge, Avcı guided Istanbul's youngest professional football club to the Super League for the first time in their brief history. Ahead of their first season in the top flight, the club took the seemingly bizarre decision to move to the 80,000-seater Atatürk Olympic Stadium, meaning they are the largest stadium of any team in Istanbul and in the Super League as a whole. Presumably this was meant as a statement of intent, but all it really did was emphasise how little support the young club had. Most local school fields would have been able to accommodate IBB's entire fanbase at the time, which typically numbered only in the hundreds, and at times, only in the tens, during their promotion campaign, when one discounts away fans who almost always outnumbered the club's home support. Whilst the stadium move might not have done a lot as a statement of intent, IBB's performances on the pitch did. Following survival in their first season, the club recorded 6th place finishes in the 2009-10 and 2011-12 campaigns, as they began to make their near neighbours sit up and take note. Many supporters of Istanbul's big three had added incentive to distrust their new rivals though, and that was because they were bankrolling their rise. Since IBB were funded by the local government, it was the taxpayers of Istanbul, who were often passionate supporters of Beşiktaş, Fenerbahçe or Galatasaray, whose tax dollars were going into keeping the club with no fans in the city's mega stadium afloat. The threat of immediate competition seemed to subside in 2013 when, just a season after they had finished 6th in the Super League for the second time, IBB were relegated. Many felt this was the end of a taxpayer-funded house of cards dreamt up by a former mayor. After all, the residents of Istanbul had seen clubs try to challenge their big three in the past before falling away once the money men lost interest. IBB weren't giving up just yet though, and they bounced back immediately, cruising to the TFF First League title in the 2013-14 campaign. Although IBB's players had won promotion to the Super League, the club's future had never looked more precarious. During campaigning for the high-profile 2014 Istanbul mayoral election, the Republican People's Party candidate Mustafa Sarıgül had promised to liquidate IBB should he be elected by the people of Istanbul. It was a popular policy, so much so that even after Sarıgül lost the election, the incumbent mayor, Kadir Topbaş of the AK party, vowed to withdraw local government funding of the newly promoted Super League side. It seemed for all the world that Istanbul Büyükşehir Belediyespor's tombstone would have the years 1990 to 2014 chiselled upon it, but Turkey's Football Federation, the TFF, were extremely reluctant about plans to disband the club. Losing a team from the Super League would have caused many headaches for Turkish football's governing body, and they were keen to find an alternative solution and alternative financing for the Istanbul outfit. In all likelihood, if IBB hadn't won promotion in the 2013-14 season, the 2014 mayoral election would have seen the end of the short-lived club. The solution was for Istanbul's local government to relinquish their involvement, replaced by Turkey's Ministry of Youth and Sports, a branch of Turkey's central government who took over the day-to-day management and financing of the club. If you're thinking that a government agency within the Turkish cabinet, which administers Turkish sport, owning a Turkish football club, could be deemed as a conflict of interest, well then, you are in agreement with the majority of Turkish football fans. What's more, the man who heads up Turkey's Ministry of Youth and Sports is this man, Mehmet Kasapoglu, who is part of President Erdogan's inner circle. A young upstart within the Erdogan government, Kasapoglu was appointed as an advisor to Erdogan when he was Prime Minister in 2009, before being appointed Minister of Youth and Sport by Turkey's ruler in 2018. As well as a change in ownership, IBB also had a change of name and a change of home in 2014. The club was renamed Istanbul Büyükşehir and relocated to the purpose-built Büyükşehir Fatih Terim Stadium, 5 miles north of the Atatürk Olympic Stadium, to the Büyükşehir district of Istanbul, hence the new name, and yes, that is Erdogan in the Büyükşehir kit for their first game following their move and name change, but more on that in a moment. The stadium was still far too large for a club with virtually no fans, with a capacity of 17,000, but the location was a significant one. The Büyükşehir district is one with close ties to President Erdogan, having been built up during his time as mayor of Istanbul, and having enjoyed much investment during Erdogan's reign as prime minister. It remains an AKP stronghold, and it's at this point that I must interject with some very terse political context. For those of you with no knowledge of Turkey's political landscape, President Erdogan has long been the nation's most prominent and powerful politician. In 1994, he became the mayor of Istanbul, in 1998, he became Turkey's prime minister, and in 2014, he was elected as the nation's 12th president. A strongman politician who doesn't take kindly to criticism, Erdogan gained unprecedented powers in 2017 through a constitutional referendum which handed him virtually unfettered control over Turkey's internal affairs. The referendum result, which Erdogan won by an incredibly tight margin, has been called into question by much of the international community, and many within Turkey, who expressed doubts at the time with regards to its legitimacy. Whether the vote was free and fair or not, its precedent is a significant one, making Erdogan the de facto dictator of Turkey, a term he would no doubt refute, along with accusations of widespread repression and authoritarianism. Erdogan can deny such claims, but his disdain for democracy is in no doubt. Once having said, democracy is like a streetcar. When you come to your stop, you get off. Before his ascent to political supremacy, Erdogan was a footballer and a prisoner. He played for fellow Istanbul club Kasımpaşa, who also currently compete in the Super League, and he made a rare return to the pitch in 2014 as Istanbul Büyükşehir moved into their new home. Erdogan scored a hat-trick in the exhibition game at the Fatih Terim Stadium, despite being in his 60s, presumably with no one going easy on him at all. in recognition of this masterclass of centre-forward play and joyous footballing exhibit from the 60-year-old, who was like Gerd Müller and Dennis Bergkamp all rolled into one, Bashiktaş retired the number 12 shirt that he wore for that game in his honour, in a decision which was the most embarrassing retirement of a shirt number right up until Jude Bellingham joined Borussia Dortmund. For anyone who hadn't felt a bit uneasy about the Ministry for Youth and Sport taking over a Super League club and relocating them to an Erdogan stronghold, his partaking in their first game at their new ground and the retiring of his shirt number may have thrown out one or two red flags. The 2014 compromise to appease the citizens of Istanbul was rapidly becoming even less popular than the former arrangement, particularly with citizens who supported any of the city's established football clubs. Tensions were heightened when it became clear the club weren't just in the Super League to make up the numbers, they were there to compete. In their first season, under new ownership and in a new home, Bashiktaş finished fourth, and they haven't finished outside of the top four in a single season since. Former boss Abdullah Avcı returned, this time fresh off the back of 2 years managing Turkey's senior team, and shrewd business was done in the transfer market. Bashiktaş's early signings weren't particularly jaw-dropping, although the arrival of veteran Turkish international Emre Belözoğlu in 2015 was significant for more than footballing reasons. Many of you will be aware of Belözoğlu due to his performances at the 2002 World Cup, his time at Newcastle United, and the repeated racism accusations he has faced, even receiving a 2.5-month suspended prison sentence for racially abusing former Tottenham midfielder Didier Zakora in 2012. When he wasn't busy running a midfield or racially abusing black people, Belözoğlu was often supporting the AKP, the party of President Erdogan, and by extension, the president himself. The signing of Belözoğlu was seen by many as further evidence of the close ties between the club and Turkey's president, as if further evidence was required. The signing of Belözoğlu was also significant for footballing reasons though, since it signalled a change in tact and a new transfer policy for Bashiktaş, which has paid dividends. Whilst the club has a strong long-term goal evidenced by their enormous investment in youth facilities and training to develop players, much of their actual recruitment has been of established veterans with vast experience, often at the highest level under their belt. Since bringing in Belözoğlu, Bashiktaş have also signed the likes of Emmanuel Adebayor, Gökhan Inler, Gael Clichy, Alireo Olaya, Kerem Fry, Robinho, Demba Ba, and Martin Skrtel. Whilst many clubs have been bitten on the backside through the signing of overpaid has-beens, Bashiktaş seem to have attracted a good mix of former stars who are willing to knuckle down and try to knock Istanbul's big three off their perch. And that is exactly what they have done this season. In some respects, Bashiktaş's title win this season could be likened to Blackburn Rovers' Premier League win in 1995, purely in as much as it is a shock which shouldn't really have come as any great shock. Just like with Blackburn in the 90s, Bashiktaş's title has been coming for a little while. As I said, the club has finished in the top four every season since coming into state ownership in 2014, and they were runners-up in 2017 and 2019. This season, Bashiktaş won the league with the game to spare, as Fenerbahçe and Galatasaray both suffered one of their worst seasons in recent years. There is of course one great difference between Bashiktaş's title win and Blackburn's though, and that is that whilst Rovers were bankrolled by a local millionaire Jack Walker, they weren't owned by Queen Elizabeth II, which would be the closest comparison, seeing as though Erdogan has himself said that he would like to be similar to the United Kingdom's head of state when faced with accusations that he wishes to be like a neo-Ottoman sultan. Whilst all successful teams face accusations of help from referees and the authorities, whether it be Fergie time at Manchester United, Donravi's robust approach at Leeds United in the 1970s, and even the current Liverpool team, with opposition fans often taking to social media to accuse them of having received favourable decisions, criticism of Bashiktaş perhaps holds a little more weight. Whilst on-field decisions are always open to debate, the decision taken by the TFF to only ban Volkan Babacan for one game after he physically assaulted a journalist 2 seasons ago, when the rules seemingly suggested that he should have been banned for at least 10 games, only strengthened the feeling in some quarters that there was a bias within the TFF towards Bashiktaş. Counter-arguments could be made, given the much more draconian 16-game ban that was handed to fellow Bashiktaş star Arda Turan after he pushed an assistant referee, but feelings of distrust and suspicion are now deep-rooted within the Turkish game. Istanbul Bashiktaş sponsorship deals come primarily from clubs that have lucrative government contracts, and in some cases, close ties to Erdogan himself. The degree to which these businesses and companies have funded Bashiktaş's rise remains unclear, since the club's books remain firmly sealed, But if there's one thing the likes of Robinho and Adebayor are not famous for, it is playing football for free. Bishakshire's wage bill is likely to be a large one, and who is footing that bill seems to be a valid complaint among football fans and indeed everyday citizens of Turkey. When Turkey's Minister of Youth and Sport, Mehmet Kasapoglu, took to Twitter to congratulate Bishakshire on their first title win, following a 1-0 win against Kayserispor on July 19th, one user responded, "It's amazing what you can do with state aid," whilst another declared, "The theatre is over. The stage is closed. You can start the celebrations with the TFF and board." And so, Istanbul Bishakshire are the sixth champions of Turkish football, but also, by far, the nation's most hated club. Even in a season which saw them lift the Super League title, they had an average attendance of just 2,892 this season, the lowest in the entire division. When one discounts away fans, given the club has faced plenty of well-supported Istanbul neighbours, in the immortal words of the great Wildstone Raider, Istanbul Bishakshire have got no fans. Given the dominance of Beşiktaş, Fenerbahçe and Galatasaray within Turkish football for so many years, viable competition ought to be a blessing for the Turkish game. But the way in which it has arrived feels tainted. Maiden title winners ought to be special, magical even, when one thinks of Leicester City's Premier League triumph in 2016, or when Deportivo La Coruña reigned supreme in La Liga in 2000, but Bishakshire are not the team of Roy Mackay's goals, Claudio Ranieri's tinkering, or Jamie Vardy's many WKD-laden parties. To many, they are the team of just one party, the AKP, and Turkey's president, and de facto dictator, Recep Tayyip Erdogan. That's it for today's video. Thank you all for watching. Obviously, give us a like if you enjoyed it. Let me know your thoughts in the comments. Make sure to subscribe if you haven't already, and feel free to follow me on social media, where the username on both Twitter and Instagram is just @HITC7s.